Good morning, and welcome to the Monday, March 8, 2010 edition of Inquisition Update. You're listening to LibertyRadioLive.com. My name's Tom Fresh, your host, to be with you for the next hour. Nice to have you with me this morning. It's nice to be back on this Monday morning. Damp, foggy Monday morning here in Central Iowa, but at least it's warming up and the snow's melting. And spring is on its way, thank God. One of the most bitter, long winters of my life. Many of you remember that I began reading the book last Monday and Tuesday, the book entitled The Ark and the Dove by J. Moss Ives. And I would like to continue in that book this morning where we left off last Tuesday, but I found it necessary to make several comments before I read this book. First of all, I want my listeners to know that this is a Roman Catholic book. This is telling the story of a voyage by two ships, the Ark and the Dove, that brought Catholics to this country. Catholics headed for the Maryland colony, a Catholic colony, a Roman Catholic colony. And as preparation for this book, we need to realize that in addition to what we've all been taught, that Protestants fled to this country to escape religious persecution and inquisitions and crusades, seeking religious liberty and freedom to worship according to the written word of God, the leading and teaching of the Holy Spirit, and according to their consciences. What is not often talked about is the fact that Great Britain, though it was a Protestant country, as a result of a dispute between Henry VIII and the papacy, Great Britain was largely a Catholic country prior to that schism between Henry VIII and the papacy over a divorce. Henry VIII wanted to divorce his wife and wanted to marry Anne Boleyn, and the Pope would not grant his divorce. And so Henry VIII severed his ties with the papacy and took over the church, the state church in Great Britain, and he held to a Protestant faith. Now, the papacy has, you know, according to its canon law, the papacy has the right, the divine right, to seat and unseat kings. And they also, the official teaching of the Roman Catholic Church is that there is no salvation outside the Roman Catholic Church. So from the papacy's point of view, what happened under the reign of Henry VIII was an extreme blow at the papacy. And it put the Catholics in Great Britain at risk, not able to enjoy their Catholic faith, at least to the extent that they were there a Catholic king on the throne. Now, the papacy set out to regain Great Britain and to reestablish the ancient faith, the Catholic faith in the country. And they did that by many, many means. The Spanish Armada, assassination attempts upon the British crown, even the gunpowder plot, an attempt to destroy the Protestant Parliament in session, and the Jesuit intrigues into the government, assassination attempts, all kinds of government intrigue, political intrigue by the Jesuits, to restore to the papacy Great Britain, lock, stock, and barrel, to unseat its Protestant form of government and its Protestant church, and to reestablish the papacy as supreme ruler of Great Britain. And, you know, with the Babington plot, the gunpowder plot, assassination attempts and everything, added to the fact that the Roman Catholic Church at that time was the largest landholder in the nation. And as we learned, as I have learned from Avril Manhattan's book, The Vatican Billions, if you'll understand that to gain favor in the Roman Catholic Church or to purchase indulgence, the forgiveness of sins for money, the Roman Catholic people gave to the church incalculable wealth, and much of that wealth was prime lands and estates in Great Britain. And it had gotten so bad that the Roman Catholic Church was the papacy was the greatest landholder in the land. Up to a third of the land was owned by the papacy and its mendicant orders, the Dominicans, Franciscans, and the papacy was the biggest landowner. And that wreaked havoc upon the economy of Great Britain. And as we've also learned from Avril Manhattan, in addition to the fact that Protestants, for the first times in their lives, received the gospel in their own language, that they could read the Bible for themselves and come to the uniform conclusion that the papacy is that described in the Bible, that it is the Antichrist Church, that the papacy is the biblical Antichrist. As you heard, if you happen to hear Greg Szymanski's investigative journal had just ended, his guest this morning was Daryl Eberhardt. And if you listen carefully, you heard Daryl make the comment that I've made many times. The Protestant reformers disagreed on many things, but there was one thing that they were universally in agreement of, and that was that the papacy, the office of the Pope, was the biblical Antichrist. Look no further for the Antichrist. Don't hold to the preterist view that Antichrist was long in the past. Nero or Antiochus Epiphanes. And don't look into the future, the futurist interpretation of Bible prophecies that says the Antichrist won't be a factor until the last 7 years of time. No, they all agreed, all the Protestant reformers uniformly agreed that that papacy was vividly described in Revelation chapter 17, and that's what fueled their coming out of the Roman Catholic Church. Now, you add to that the fact that the papacy owned a third of the land in Great Britain, also adding fuel to the drive to separate from Rome. Number one, it was the Antichrist Church of the Bible. Number two, it owned all the land in a Protestant country. It owned a third of the land in the Protestant country. And if Protestantism became the national religion of Great Britain, then the government could nationalize and take over the land and put it back into production to profit the country rather than the papacy. And what resulted when Great Britain became Protestant was that the papacy wanted her land back, the papacy wanted the crown back, the papacy wanted Parliament back, the papacy wanted the church back. And so they made every attempt, every intrigue, every assault on the British crown to restore the Roman Catholic Church to its original glory and control, ultimately controlled Great Britain. And because of so much Jesuit intrigue and attempts on the lives of the crown and Parliament, the Gunpowder Plot, the Babington Plot, on and on and on, Great Britain had to go into defense mode, a strong defense mode. And it made it illegal for Roman Catholics to hold public office. It made it illegal for Catholics to have any powerful influence at all in the government or in secular society. And they kicked the Jesuits out of Great Britain. And there was great, great suffering by Catholics in Protestant Great Britain Catholics first in Great Britain found themselves under the same types of persecution, although not nearly as bloody. But the same types of persecution that God's people always suffered under the hand of the papacy. And you heard Daryl Eberhard earlier talking about the Waldenses and the Albigenses and the Huguenots and on and on and on. The Crusades that were launched against innocent, hard-working, Bible-believing, God-fearing people who simply wanted to worship God according to the Bible. They were tortured, they were stretched on the rack, their thumb screws were applied, they were starved to death, they were burned at the stake, they were gutted and their babies ripped from their wombs and bashed against the walls. And this isn't hate speech, it's documented history. 605 consecutive years over the terms of 83 popes, Rome mercilessly warred against God's people. With unspeakable horror and death and torture. And for the first time, the Roman Catholics of Great Britain began to suffer under this Protestant church and this Protestant government that had come to power in Great Britain. Not allowed to own property, not allowed to work in the government, not allowed to have anything but the mere existence. It was pretty tough going. So there were Catholics in Great Britain that also sought religious liberty and freedom from religious persecution. And they too wished to come to America. To have that liberty, the same liberty and freedoms that the Protestants sought. Freedom from religious persecution. Now, the thesis of this book, what we're going to learn from this book is that they did come to this country. And I want to emphasize that it was Christopher Columbus, under the sanction of Roman Catholic Spanish Queen and King Ferdinand and Isabella, which were sanctioned by the Pope to claim all lands in the Western Hemisphere for the Pope, that is for Roman Catholicism, that they sent Christopher Columbus. And it is to him that is credited of having landed on the American continent. And it is Rome's claim of the Americas for the Pope. And as we all know, he claims to be the Vicar of Christ, the sole teacher of Christians, the universal bishop, the replacement of the Son of God, the Vicar of Christ, and by divine right he should have all the power and all the jurisdiction of Christ himself. Over heaven and the earth, his spiritual power and his temporal power. And it is Rome's claim that through Christopher Columbus and through his divine right that the Americas belong to the Pope and that Catholicism is the official religion. Because anything besides Catholicism is heresy. According to official Roman Catholic teaching, that has never changed, ever, and it never will change. You can't reform the Roman Catholic Church. And to add to that, the Vatican sent Jesuit missionaries to this country. They surveyed the land from coast to coast, from border to border. They assessed the natural resources of the land. They mapped out the land. They studied the Indians and their religion, the indigenous people of the Americas. They established trade with the Indians to finance their activities in this country. They built missions every 30 miles up and down the coast of California and all across the land. Jesuit missionaries opened schools, began to teach the Indians, made treaties with the Indians. And Rome has always behaved as though she owned this land. Now, God says, the earth is mine and the fullness thereof. But the Pope says, as vicar of Christ, the earth is mine and the fullness thereof. And to think that after the expedition of Christopher Columbus and the Jesuit hordes that came to this country to claim this land and set a precedent in this country for the Pope, that the Pope would simply walk away and allow this country to become a Protestant country without some future design, even if it had to live in peace with the Protestants for a goodly amount of time, you must know. You must know that Rome's never going to relinquish her claim over the Americas. Now, if you're a regular listener to Inquisition Update, you know what I think of the papacy. You know what I think of Roman Catholicism. And you know what I think about the Bible and about God's people. Those who protested Rome, those who came to this country to found this country, make it a godly nation. And if you're like anything like me, you believe that this is a Protestant nation. I've always believed it. But as we read in the book Rulers of Evil, we understand that the Jesuits had a great deal to do with the Revolutionary War, to separate the United States from Great Britain, the colonies from Great Britain. And there was a strategy behind that. And that is to ensure religious freedom so that Protestantism didn't become the law of the land, that Catholics who came to this country could worship according to Roman Catholic canon law. They could worship the Pope. But is it really religious freedom that Rome wants? If you're a regular listener to Inquisition Update, you realize, and we've proven it voluminously on this program, that we're losing our Protestant liberties. Our government has turned against our Protestant liberties. And they're being destroyed. The Patriot Act. Just one that comes to mind. And the others are the executive orders that are passed by the executive branch of this government that absolutely gut the Constitution and the liberties, the uniquely Protestant liberties embodied in our Declaration of Independence and Constitution, Bill of Rights. Now, my listeners shouldn't be curious, shouldn't be clueless at all who it is that most wants to destroy those liberties. It's the Pope of Rome. And have proven that through the books that we've read, Rulers of Evil, just one, only one. And the encyclical by Benedict XVI, Caritas in Veritate, the tenets of the Manhattan Declaration. They're instruments of Roman Catholicism, the ecumenical movement that has infiltrated and destroyed Protestantism in this country. We're headed to a Catholic form of government, not just in this world and not just in the Americas, but all over the world, a global papal hegemony. That is the New World Order. And we've brought the Bible to bear. Revelation chapter 13, we've come to realize through Nicholas Arthur and Bill Hughes that it's the United States that's spoken of as the second beast. That beast that came out of the wilderness, the beast that came out of the land, that makes an image to the first beast, which we all agree is Rome. This lamb that come out of the wilderness, this beast that had two horns like a lamb. It looked Christian, but it speaks like a dragon. What has happened to America? If we understand the scriptures, we have to realize that the United States starts out as a Christian nation and it becomes a dragon nation. And it was the dragon who gave the papacy his seat and power and great authority. And it's the United States, which looks lamb-like but speaks like a dragon, that causes the whole world to worship the first beast, the Pope. So what happened? We have to understand what happened. It's a subject that is avoided like the plague. How did the United States become a dragon-like government? And where does it get its authority to impose upon the world a beast-like universal world government under the headship of the Pope? What happened to quote-unquote Protestant America? And it is believed that when we get into this book, The Ark and the Dove, we're going to learn some things that's going to help us make sense of how this land could be transformed from that lamb-like image to that of the dragon. And we're going to have to come to grips with some really painful realities. Now, we've explored the scriptures with Nicholas Arthur and Bill Hughes. Now we have to explore history. And we did that through Rulers of Evil by F. Tupper Saucy. Now, I don't agree with everything F. Tupper Saucy says, but nonetheless, the book is instructive. And this book, The Ark and the Dove, is going to fill some holes for us. It's going to help us understand even better how this lamb-like, Christian, Bible-believing, Protestant nation could somehow in its history be transformed into that which speaks as a dragon and causes the whole world to worship the first beast. This book, The Ark and the Dove, is going to fill in the blanks, so that we can confirm our interpretation of Revelation chapter 13 and chapter 17, and we can also explain why our government is destroying Protestantism in the churches and in the Constitution, Bill of Rights, and Declaration of Independence. Our national sovereignty is being destroyed. We're slowly but surely being conformed to this new global government of the Pope. And through all this, we have to realize that we're returning to the dark days of the Inquisition, where religious persecution will define the day.
In his heart.